Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit. Bandwidth for the new screensavers is provided by CashFly at CACHEFLY.com. The new screensavers is brought to you by the Ring Video Doorbell. With Ring, you can see and talk to anyone at your door from anywhere in the world using your smartphone. It's like caller ID for your house. Go to ring.com/NSS and get $50 off one of their Ring of Security kits, the bundle kit or the pro bundle kit with this limited time offer. And by Epson's new EcoTank printers. With Epson's line of Super Tank all-in-one printers, you can print thousands of documents without running out of ink. EcoTank, loaded and ready to print when you are. Visit Epson.com/EcoTank to find out more.
How to high-tech your homebrew, aging bourbon in a day, and getting paid for your data. For the last time, live from the Twit Brick House in beautiful downtown Petaluma, it's the new screensaver!
Welcome to the new screensavers. Hello, everybody. The last new screensavers in the old Brick House studios. We're moving on up to the East Side studio next week.
There's Alex a lot Lindsay. To move. That's all I got to say. I mean, I'm looking around. I know that you're moving, and I'm just saying that
you
got a lot left over.
Some guys, big guys with trucks are coming
soon. You got to have a lot of them. That's all I'm saying.
Yikes. And I want to thank Scott and Anna from Houston, Texas. Didn't they? Aren't they sweet? What a cute couple. They met 7 years ago. They started listening to the show then, and they're married now, and living in Houston, and came up here for the show. Thank you. It's nice to meet you both. We have a fun show. We're going to get drunk today.
Outstanding. Hey-o. That's all
we're going to be
say.
Making beer. We're going to be tasting bourbon. It's going to be a lot
I
of fun.
I see that you built the show for me.
Yeah. Well, when it comes to Alex Lindsay, there's two things I know. Video production and booze. So, and sous vide if we had it, but we
yes.
don't have
sometimes
sous vide.
The sous vide with
actually,
the booze
we're gonna do that
shooting
next
video
week.
About it.
So the next week episode is going to be kind of a weird one because we're not going to do it from here, but the new studio isn't ready. I'm going to be at the new studio, and we're going to shoot that before we move in so you can kind of see what's going on over there. It'll just be me, no co-host, and we have a number of segments, including a cooking segment with sous vide and modern technology.
The meat's already in there, right?
The meat is cooking right now. Actually, it's pork chops. It's incredible. You were there, Kara. You know, they were delicious. We're also going to visit the Obi-Wan Museum. You've heard of this, haven't you?
I have not.
What's it called? Rancho Obi-Wan. It's like this private Star Wars collection in the area. It's famous.
I got locked out of this.
Rancho Obi-Wan. And the third thing we're going to do... we're going to tear down a Nintendo system and show you how that works. So that's going to be a lot of fun. So we will have a show, but it'll be a little bit of a different show and a lot of tour of the new studio. And then we'll be doing our first new screensavers from the East Side studio. Ian Thompson will join us 2 weeks from today. Wow. In fact, we have video, I think. This is we have Nest Cams up. We're also, John's been doing time-lapse videos of the studio construction. Do you have the, yeah. So this is the entry. You'll come in here. And the studio, see the round porthole and the door, that's where the studio is. The office people here said, we do not want to be in the studio anymore. We have to shut up all the time. You're always saying shush, shush, shush. So they said, we're going to seal, this time the studio is going to be its own, like a normal TV studio. So there it is. They actually, we had to reopen the wall. Oh, look, here's a time lapse. We had to reopen the walls because some of the wiring wasn't complete in there. So we took some of the drywall back off. And they're doing that. You see the lighting rigging's up. Mm-hmm. There's a raised floor, a metal raised floor under there that we can run conduit through. The carpet tiles are just kind of glued on. We can remove
those.
That
is the key to the operation. Raised floors are...
Yeah. Well, here we had a basement. We don't have a basement there. It's on a slab. So it was either trenching the slab out.
Right.
But then Russell was at NAB, and he found these floors that are only a couple of inches. I think it's an inch and a half. And they just go in like Lego. It was actually kind of cool.
You drive tanks over those.
Yeah. And it wasn't much more expensive than the trenching, so we decided to go with that. We're going to actually have a farewell.
Oh, there it is.
Oh, we have one. Here you go.
Ooh, and those are metal.
Oh, yeah, it's solid.
We use some of them on site that are made out of plastic.
We did our due diligence. There are here's the floor getting put in.
Yep.
We did our due diligence. Number studios in the area even use this.
Yeah, those are great.
Yeah. Isn't that cool? It's called, what is it called? Do you remember the name?
Free Access.
Grid. It's Free AXEZ, and it's called the Grid with two Ds, Grid.
And then these peel up?
No.
This is a solid unit. There's other units that go on the side here. The carpet peels up, and then you can have access to the, and you can move it around. You can put wires anywhere. So that's pretty cool. Nice, huh? We had to solve a few problems when we moved. We also have 10 gigabit symmetric internet. Sonic.net, 10 gigabits. But you'll see all that in a little bit. We're going to have a tribute video later on from the staff saying farewell. Some people love this place. Turned out I loved it, but a lot of people weren't as fond of it as I am.
I think it worked really well.
There were some issues. It's an old building, and there were some issues. I think it's haunted. We'll talk about that. We're going to... Yeah, it'll be haunted by my spirit.
There are people in my company that believe that would agree with you on that.
That it's haunted.
Yeah, there were people that are not.
You used to be in this building.
We did. Yeah. On the other.
We sublet it to Alex. Yeah. To Pixel Corp. We're also going to talk about how you can make whiskey, beautiful brown liquor, in a week. Now, normally this would be aged for years in oak barrels. But thanks to the miracle of chemistry and a company called Cleveland Whiskey, we're going to talk to the founder and CEO. And then we're going to do a bourbon tasting to see what you think.
Love that.
See if you can figure out which is the week-old whiskey compared to the... I think we have some 16-year-old whiskey here. We shall see.
Because this has become a real problem. There is so much a demand for whiskey that they literally can't make it fast enough.
Yeah, I don't think that's a problem. But we are going to make some beer.
Yes.
Look behind you. That is the Pico Brew. It is a home-brewing device.
It's like a coffee machine for beer.
It makes beer. It takes 2.5 hours to mush it all up together and then about a week to ferment it, and you're going to get fresh, delicious beer. And if you would do the honors, press the start button because you can start it brewing.
Start brewing.
And that's it.
There
and this
it is.
Thing will... Oh, dear. Did you know it was going to sound like that? Oh, dear. It's mushing the mash.
Just every once in a while.
You get all the... We'll show you, but they get all the ingredients in like this pre-sealed thing, and you just put it in.
Love.
It keeps the temperature. It's kind of like no muss, no fuss beer brewing, but you can then play with the recipe, try other stuff.
I think we're really getting to a point that you just need a lab next to your kitchen.
This is like a little lab.
You have like a sous vide cooker, and you have this, and you have smokers, and you have... There's like a whole like little section there.
And we have some beer that we made earlier that you and I can try after the bourbon. So basically, this is a reverse Boilermaker show.
Yeah, I think I'm just going to have an Uber pick me up on the way out.
You see the gear? He's standing next to the gear. We took the gear down. That's the gear. We had to punch a hole in the middle. We couldn't get the middle part out. That's okay. My head will be there. That's fine. Or a moose. We haven't decided which. And coming up in just a bit, a friend of mine, David Glickman, we've interviewed him before on Triangulation. He has a new company called Our Data. It's a new twist on ad blocking. And I think it's really the right way to do this that makes everybody happy. Because, you know, we're ad-supported. I'm sympathetic to websites that say, look, if you block all our ads, we have no revenue. We can't keep doing what we're doing. It costs us money to do this. I'm sympathetic to that. So there's got to be a way that everybody can be happy. And we think we've found it. Actually, that's a fight going on right now on Facebook. So Facebook announced we are going to be able to get around ad blocking.
And then the ad blockers immediately...
No, you don't. And then 3.5 hours later, AdBlock Plus said, oh, we figured out a way to get around the get around. But then Facebook said, well, actually, the get around on the get around is actually blocking more than just ads. It's also blocking accounts. It's blocking posts from friends and family. You can let that run. That's fine. We want beer. We know it's going to make
now,
noise.
Under no circumstances should we disrupt the
making. Do not
the
disrupt
of the
Pico Brew. What's it doing now? Is it milking?
It's filling the water. So it's milking it.
It's milking the cow.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, it looks like, so I guess this whole section's in here and it's filling it up with
It's filling it with water.
Hot water.
Is it hot?
210 degrees, I think.
What the what? You're making Tweeties? That's the name of the beer? Speaking of tweets.
Tweeties. It's like Wheaties.
Did you see the article on BuzzFeed? This was a great article. called Twitter. I can't even say the name of the what they call it. A honeypot for a-holes. They said, and I think this is actually true, that the thesis of this article is that the reason Twitter has never failed to stop harassment and abuse, despite constantly talking about it, is it's in their DNA. When Twitter was founded, it was founded, they even said, we are the free speech wing of the free speech party.
My daughter once tweeted, she goes, you know, she said, fear leads to anger, anger leads to hate, and hate leads to Twitter.
I think that was in Dune, as I remember, yeah. Well, this is a damning article, and it really explains why it's going to be almost impossible for Twitter to fix this. When I read this, all I could do was nod and say, yeah. Most people who are trolled and harassed on Twitter don't even come forward because they don't want more harassment.
Right.
And it is much more widespread than anybody realizes.
I got a bit trolled. I tweeted something about the Apple issue with the phone, and before I knew it, Donald Trump had tweeted at me.
What? You've been tweeted by Donald Trump?
I did.
What did he say?
Oh, you know, he was...
We're going to make Alex Lindsay great again?
No,
he
did not say that. He said something nasty about me, and I basically said that if you're not standing with Apple, if you're not standing with Apple, you're basically already admitted that you're compromised if you're a tech leader.
Right.
You know, and that somehow ended up on CNN, and then Donald Trump, you know, sent out some nasty tweet about how I was protecting, you know,
you're stupid and a loser.
Yeah, exactly. And then I started getting all the tweets from his followers, which was an eye-opening experience.
Well, see, that's what's happening is that people on Twitter, like Milos Yiannopoulos, who's banned, know how to stir up trouble in a way that's got some deniability, right? Oh, I didn't say anything. I just observed. I was being sarcastic. And then suddenly, this army that knows the dog whistle, they respond, and it's just become a nightmare on Twitter. I've actually stopped using it. I'm sad to say, because I think it was a lot of good in Twitter, but the way they decided to do it with total free speech, it's just ultimately never going to work.
Well, I think that you see that in not only just in Twitter, but in, you know, you look at YouTube. You know, we work with a lot of people doing live streaming for YouTube, and you basically decide it's either going to be just a line of drool going down the side,
the
or you're going to turn off the comments, the
now,
live chat.
Now, did it get better when Google said, oh, you have to have a Google Plus account?
Well, it started to go better, and then, of course, everyone got upset about that, so they went back to letting it be anonymous again, and now it's just back to kind of useless, you know, kind of spool of, you know, stuff that you don't want to look at.
One observation I have is that when you use your real name, you tend to be nicer.
Yep.
Than when you're using a pseudonym. When you're completely not responsible for what you post, you'll say anything.
Well, and when we started the Pixel Corps, when we had a huge membership, we had, you know, thousands of people. They had their photo, they had their name.
People are much nicer.
And it was a very simple conversation. I think.
I understand
important.
The need for anonymous posting. And look, in the Arab Spring, Twitter was huge in helping overturn. These governments, and you couldn't do it if you were doing it with your real name, or you would be persecuted in that country.
Right.
So I understand the value of whistleblowing and of anonymous, but at the same time, it really, I think maybe we've made that a fetish. And stuff like where Facebook and Google Plus, where people are using their real names, tends to be much nicer. Now that Google Plus has dropped the real name policy and seems to have dropped paying attention to Google Plus,
well,
it started
that.
To go back downhill again.
Right.
And I think that's true of any internet community. It's like a garden. It needs to be constantly maintained. And there's a lot to be said for having to use your real name. You know, we don't use our real name in our chat room. We allow people to have handles. And I think that's a great thing. That's the way people use the internet. But I think the problem is we're idealists, internet idealists, who really thought, oh, let free speech reign, democratize this, let everybody have a voice. And the good will rise, the cream will rise. But what happened is a very small number of people also were empowered and voiced, and they really get involved in everything.
Well, and it's,
I don't know what
it's a very small number. I mean,
it's
tiny. That's the worst part, is it's like 1% ruining it for everybody else.
All it takes is one bad apple.
Right.
So I just don't know what the answer is. And for me, my personal answer is just stay away from places where I'm harassed. I just don't want to participate in that.
Right.
That's life. All right, we're going to talk more about, of course, all of these topics as we always do tomorrow, This Week in Tech. It's all in studio tomorrow, and Allyn Malventano is going to be stopping by from PC Perspective and Twitch. I'm really thrilled. Allyn's here. We're going to have him. We're going to enlist his help with the bourbon tasting because he's from Kentucky. So that counts. Also, Devendra Hardawar will be in studio from Engadget, Alex Wilhelm from Mattermark, and Greg Farrow. So that'll be a lot of fun. That's tomorrow on This Week in Tech. Now, let's talk about whiskey. I've been waiting for this for a long time. Joining us now, Tom Licks. He's the founder and CEO of Cleveland Whiskey. Hi, Tom.
Hello, how are you?
I am doing great. So
you're going to do better soon.
So tell me about Cleveland Whiskey. What is the premise here behind Cleveland Whiskey?
So I'll tell you what we're not. We're not a craft distiller. We're not a micro distiller. We're really an innovation and technology company. And, you know, we anticipated this sort of worldwide demand and the whiskey shortage and thought there was a better way to do things where you didn't have to put something in the barrel and wait for 6 or 8 or 10 or 12 years. I'm not that patient a person. And I think there's some better ways to do things. And you've got three products I see there in front of you.
Yeah.
One of them is sort of a traditional oak made bourbon, and the other two we actually use different woods, so they're entirely different in the whiskey space.
So this is the traditional bourbon. And how old is it?
So well, you know what, why don't you taste it first?
Actually, I'll let Alex, who's more of a bourbon guy, taste it.
And then
so the way normally whiskey is made is the same way any spirit is made. You ferment something.
Right.
And distill it, which gets the water out, increases the alcohol content. And then, if you drank it, then it'd be corn liquor, basically. It would be...
And it'd be pretty nasty.
It'd be pretty nasty. So then you put it typically in something like an oak barrel, and you age it for a long time, sometimes 16 years.
Right. Yeah. Well, in fact, for a bourbon, you have to put it in a new American oak charred barrel. That's part of the definition. The good news for us is they didn't say how long it had to be in the barrel, but does have to go into this new American oak charred barrel. That's part of the definition of bourbon.
So you are doing that.
We are. We just don't leave it in the barrel for very long. We can, you know, it's like you pour it in and then we pour it right out. And, you know, we can't
well,
use
wait
those
a minute.
Barrels.
So are you doing just that just for legal purposes so you can call it bourbon, or does it actually enhance the flavor?
Unfortunately, yes, we do it for legal purposes.
Wow.
So we can call it a bourbon. We really don't
actually,
have to
that's
use
not bad.
No, it's good.
Yeah, we still have to use wood, but we use pressure vessels, and essentially we're almost doing the same thing that's going on in a barrel anywhere way, where every day you have 24-hour temperature cycles that changes the pressure inside the barrel, and that's moving the alcohol in and out of the pore structure of the wood, and you get anywhere from 60 to 80% of the flavor and all of the color through the interaction with the wood.
So really, you figure out a way to speed up time. How long does Cleveland bourbon get aged for?
Well, so what you just tasted was probably in a barrel for a day or two, and then it went through our process for 24 hours. So that's only a couple days old.
Well, and I guess that one of the things...
It doesn't taste fresh. It tastes like bourbon.
This tastes like bourbon. It tastes great.
I'm not an expert.
You know, I don't know if I'm an expert, but I have a lot of experience. And so I... I'd say that this is a very, you know, it's a good bourbon. Now, one of the things, I guess, it also, in addition to dealing with the shortage that we were talking about a little earlier, I guess this also allows you to innovate a lot faster because you're not sitting
there
for 10
woods,
or 15
like
years
between
iterations.
Wood,
is that right?
Right. It really does. Now, so I think you're drinking the bourbon that we finished
this
with black
cherry
wood. You could make a barrel out of black cherry wood, but it would leak like a sieve, and most other woods are like that. I mean, oak is a beautiful container, and that's really what it was designed as a storage container, as a way to transport.
Is that good?
And it was
like
only
a little
an accidental discovery that said, hey, it will make it taste better. But there's beautiful woods out there like black cherry, and we can do some amazing things because of the technology.
One of my favorite whiskeys is Glenmorangie, which is aged in port wood. So that's one way they get some flavor. It's still an oak barrel, but the oak has been used to make port. Then they reuse the barrel, and that adds some port texture and flavor to a whiskey.
Right. So I mean, essentially, it's because the port is left in that
still
other
in
barrel.
There. Yeah.
So it's like pouring a little port into your bourbon.
It's delicious. But I understand the desire to put apple wood or cherry wood. That really gives you an interesting... Now,
and there is, and the beauty here is there's no sugar, no syrup, no artificial flavor or color. All of the flavor in those comes from the wood.
You're not dyeing it. You're not dyeing it. It's not dyed brown. This is actually from the wood.
That's the color from the wood. You'll notice if you look at those two bottles that are underground bottles there that are on the sides, they're different colors, and that's because of the wood that's used. I think the black cherry will be a little darker than the apple that's there. Yeah. But and they have entirely different flavors.
They really do.
Yeah.
So how long have you been doing this, and what's the reaction been? What's the marketplace like?
So we've been shipping since March of 2013. We're in about 13 states. We're in Germany, France, Belgium, Switzerland, Japan. And yesterday we got our first order from China. Wow. That was a big deal. But we are called heretics in the industry. People think
sex. Yeah.
They're not very happy with it. We just keep plugging away. And I think the beauty also of the technology is we keep making things better. So what we make today is better than what we made a year ago. That's better than what we made the year before that. And we'll keep doing that.
Because you can innovate.
And I think, that's the whole thing, is that your iteration is so much faster than everybody else's. Everyone else is really based on tradition, whereas yours is really based on just constant. You can change it every week, right?
Right, exactly. And in fact, we do. We're experimenting with mesquite, with pear wood, with pistachio, with a whole range of different things. And, you know, some of them don't work out, and the other ones are really great. So
the other thing I love is you're one of the first companies to use the newly created equity crowdfunding system. This is came out of the Jobs Act. In the past with crowdfunding, you know, we were talking about Kickstarter. I'd give some money to a company. Maybe I'd get a product, but I wouldn't get a piece of the company. You're doing it so that people who help fund this are actually getting stock in the company.
Yes. They actually get stock in the company. And the beautiful thing for Cleveland Whiskey is that we wind up with a lot of new owners who are customers, who are fans, who become evangelists.
I love that.
You know, since we started this a couple of months ago, we have new conversations with French distributors. We're in a chain of retail stores in upstate New York we never would have been in, all because of our customers who are now owners going out and saying, hey, you should carry this product.
That's great. And are you available in California?
We're not in California yet, so if anybody is watching and they are a distributor, please give us a call.
It's not a legal issue. It's just that you don't have a distributor in the area.
We're just not there yet, right.
So how did you get started in this? Were you a traditional whiskey maker before this?
Well, sort of yes and no. I learned spirits making when I was in the Navy 40-some years ago, making bootleg spirits. I was
You're making Prudhoe!
This is a story I don't tell everywhere. You know, we had President Obama come and visit the distillery, and I did not tell him, the commander-in-chief, this story. But, so I was the apprentice of somebody who had tapped into the steam lines and the seawater lines. He was fermenting fruit juice from the galley. He was making what he called hooch for the ship. Not only our ship, but all the surrounding ships. He had this amazing business going on, and I trained under him. I mean, later I had a software company. I did all sorts of other things, but I always wanted to go back to spirits.
Tom, I am really thrilled we could have you on. That is a great story, and I wish you all the best. Cleveland Whiskey you can't buy it online, probably.
Buy it online. If you go to our website, clevelandwhiskey.com, you can buy it online. You can also click a button there that says invest if you're interested in investing. There's a couple of things.
I think that's great. You could buy a $100 share in Cleveland and have some stake in what's happening.
And you're actually in Cleveland.
We are in Cleveland, right in downtown Cleveland.
I think that your motto,
I was in Cleveland recently, and I can't believe I didn't know. I would have come
next time you're there, you should come by. I'd love to have you come by.
I definitely will.
And your motto is, it's the water, right? No, that's not your motto. This is so cool. So the underground.
One of our motto is radically different. No excuses.
I like it. I really like it. So in a minute, we're going to do a tasting, and we actually have some traditional. You told us it kind of compares to Knob Creek, so we're going to try it with some Knob Creek and some Woodford Reserve, some traditional bourbons that are aged for many, many years, and I have a couple of bourbon experts. Well, at least bourbon drinkers.
And those are definitely good bourbons. The key is, especially with the Knob Creek, you want to compare something that's the same proof.
Right.
So Knob Creek should be 100 proof. Our Cleveland Black Reserve is 100 proof. That makes for a good, fair comparison.
Fair enough. Hey, Tom, really a pleasure talking to you. Thank you for joining us.
Same here.
All right.
Thank you so much.
Tasting in a moment. Take care and good luck with Cleveland. Everybody should. What's the website? Cleveland?
ClevelandWhiskey.com.
Whiskey.com. All right, we're going to get ready for our tasting here in a moment. While we're doing that, we've got a blind tasting. So we've got it all set up. So you guys are going to be tasting this, but you won't know which is the Cleveland, which is the Knob Creek, which is the Woodford. You'll have to decide for yourself. Before we do that, I'm going to mention the Ring Video Doorbell. This is the opposite of a blind tasting. With the Ring Video Doorbell, you know who's at your door because you've got a camera, a microphone, and a speaker there. Go to ring.com/NSS, and you're going to get a great idea of what you could do with a Ring Video Doorbell. The Ring Video Doorbell is amazing. We've got one on our door, and we've had one for some time now. I know when people are coming and going because it's got motion detection. I know when somebody's out there. When a package arrives and they ring the doorbell saying, you need to sign for this, I can say, hey, I'd love to. Can I do it tomorrow? I'm in the bathtub right now. Just leave it there. Russell, our IT guy, he gets a lot of deliveries. He's a contracting IT guy. He's never in the office. So he's got a Ring doorbell out there. He says to the guys, here's the code to the door. Just leave it inside. I can keep an eye on my package. I can keep an eye on who's there. And, you know, in the summertime, a lot of people canvass neighborhoods trying to find out who's away on vacation. Ring the doorbell. If you don't answer, they go around back. They break in. With the Ring Video Doorbell, you will answer even if you're on vacation, because no matter where you are, you're internet connected to your doorbell. You could say, hey, I'm here right now. What do you want? And the guy will say, oh, sorry, wrong number, and run away. It really is effective. And if they don't, by the way, you have crystal clear HD video of them. Now, I've got a great deal for you, because the problem with the Ring is it's just your front door. Wouldn't you like one on your back door and the sides? Well, you can. We've got a Ring of security bundle right now that gives you not only the Ring Video Doorbell to watch your front door, but also gives you the Ring stick-up cam, which you can put anywhere else. Works exactly the same. It's got a HD camera. It's got a microphone. It's got a speaker. It is also wireless because it's connected to your Wi-Fi, and it gets its power from the solar panel that we're going to give you as well. You also get, besides the stick-up cam, the solar panel, the Ring Video Doorbell, you also get the chime, which you plug into any port. Any plug, you can tell I've been working in the computer business too long. Any power plug.
Any power source.
Power source. And it will ring as well as your ding-donger in the hall. And that's nice because a lot of times there's parts of the house, you know, way out back at the, you know, if you're out in your workshop or whatever that don't ring, you just put that in the plug there and it's connected to the internet. So as long as you've got the internet there, you can also hear the doorbell ring wherever you are. All of this together, a special bundle. It's either the Ring, regular Ring bundle, or Ring of Security Kit, or the Pro Bundle Kit, and you're going to get $50 off right now if you go to ring.com/NSS. That's the lowest price anywhere. Ring.com/NSS. I love my Ring Video Doorbell. I know you will, too. Give it a try. We thank them so much for the support of the new screensavers. All right, gentlemen.
It's only missing one thing.
What's that?
Laser beams.
Oh, well, you know.
We sighted. Could, self-sighting we could hack laser that. Beams. That's all I'm saying.
So we have pre-poured.
I smelled bourbon, so I came over.
Yeah. This is Allyn Malventano. You see him on This Week in Computer Hardware.
Oh, go on the other side here.
Allyn is also, where are we going to put
here?
It?
I guess he's going over here.
Where do I
here.
Put his booze?
I'll be over here.
He's
over
also here. A expert on storage and hard drives and writes regularly for PC Perspective, but he also lives in Kentucky.
I do.
Which is the home, is it not, of Kentucky bourbon, the finest bourbon in the world.
I have been to the place where they make the Woodford Reserve, which is one of the ones where we're going to taste.
So today we're trying the Cleveland. I don't want to put them too close because I don't want you to compare colors. We're going to try the Cleveland, we're going to try the Woodford Reserve, and we're going to try Knob Creek. These are all roughly the same, proof.
Are the numbers supposed to be the different ones?
Yes, there's numbers on the bottom. So you're just going to say...
I have three of the same. That would not go well.
Yes. Well, how do you know which is which? Oh, here.
You two take.
Yeah, then you take one of these.
And I'll take
one of the. Whoa!
Okay,
that's the Woodford. No, there's enough still in there.
Didn't even start drinking.
Three. Right. So I have a one, three, and a six.
Yeah, I got a one, three, and a six.
Okay, let's all taste the one and see what we think.
All right.
We should be doing it this at the end of the episode, Father Robert says. One has some nice vanilla notes.
Yep.
It's not super potent.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Stop kicking. You don't have
Alex.
To drink it all,
easy,
Alex.
Easy, buddy.
I'm not gonna.
There's the one. There's
second,
the one.
Second thought.
You know, it's okay if this smells like a brewery. It's gonna be a brewery. So we don't really care if I spill a little whiskey here. What do you want to do next?
Are we going to three?
Three? All right, we'll do the three next.
All right.
Alex, you're such a pro. Mm-hmm.
It's good.
Oh, it's different. It's very different, right? I like that. This tastes a little more potent.
Yeah, a little bit more, little spice to it.
Spice.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay.
Okay, and then the six. And let's start by you just tell me what you like best. This isn't six, that's a two?
That's a two.
Okay. I was wondering why you did one, three, and six. All right, this is two. Hmm. Okay, this has a whole nother thing going on. All right, what do you think, gentlemen? First of all, which one do you think was aged like a few days?
So I'm going to guess that number two is this one.
You think, so let's put Alex, you're going to put the two next to the Cleveland.
Wait, you have a two?
Yeah, that's the six.
I called it six, but it looks like
it's a two.
It's a two upside down.
Yeah, I think that's two.
You think two is the Cleveland?
I think that's two.
I think the one is the Cleveland, personally. Okay. All right. Okay.
I think
which
one
is the knob?
I think, what was the first one we had? We had the first one was the one,
number
right?
One.
We went one,
yes.
Three, two.
Uh-huh.
So I'm going to say that the three is the knob.
Mm. Yeah, because I'm pretty sure that the number one is Woodford.
Yep.
Really? All right.
And I only say that because I have walked through their plant.
You so, have it in your blood.
Yeah, I've walked through their
I'm going to say the three is Woodford and the six is Knob
right,
Creek.
So yeah, I'm with Alex.
You're with Alex?
All right. All right.
So,
okay.
That was fun. Now I don't know what to do next. Oh, you tell me.
Now we might be horribly wrong.
Number one is Woodford Reserve.
Is Woodford Reserve.
Got it.
All right.
Number two is Cleveland.
Number two is Cleveland. You both got that one right.
Right.
I was the only one who got all three wrong.
That's because you were drinking with the experts. We have drank
and
many
gallons.
And the
experts got every single one right. You guys nailed it. Congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
Now,
thank you.
The most important thing is, if I served you this, would you turn your nose up at it?
No.
Not at all.
It's comparable.
It's just that it's a different taste.
It's just different, and you recognize the different tastes of the others.
Yeah.
I think the thing that distinguishes this one, I think, is there's a little bit of a cinnamon that I don't taste in the
normally
other two.
In a whiskey.
There was just like a little bit of a spice to it.
Yeah. So I think that was the thing that distinguishes it, I think, a bit. I think it's very good.
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Yeah. It's like tingly.
Yep.
Yeah, so that's maybe, interesting.
Yeah.
All right, well, I guess it passes. Tom, what do you think? The bourbon experts got it all right. Leo, though, I loved them all, man.
Well, I think that's great. You know, and everybody has different taste buds. You'll taste things differently. It's like, I know, you know, I can't stand asparagus, but people love asparagus, and I don't understand that. So everybody will taste everything differently. But the point here is that we're trying to make something comparable with that Cleveland Black Reserve. When we get to the Cleveland Underground, we're trying to take things into a whole new age of whiskey.
I have to say, you could easily serve this, and people would love it, and would probably not say a word until you told
absolutely.
Them.
Absolutely. It totally fits in with the other two that we had there.
These were very, this was challenging.
They're all comparable. Yeah. Absolutely. And I think that, you know, I'm actually interested in it because of that spice. I'm interested in using it in things like a Negroni or a Manhattan or other things just to see how that...
It would interact
differently. Completely differently.
But at no point do you say, oh, that's corn liquor. It's not. No, it's really,
not at
really
all.
Good.
It's very
well
good.
Done, Tom. Thank you. And thank you for putting up with our informal tasting.
Hey, thanks for having me on the show.
All right. Take care. Tom Licks, founder and CEO of Cleveland Whiskey, clevelandwhiskey.com.
That was great.
I'm out.
All right. Thank you, Allyn. It's great to see you. Allyn will be back tomorrow
on the Twit Roundtable.
And if we get any hard drive questions between now and then, we'll be sure to ask you. I ask Allyn, when Allyn gets here, poor guy, I just pick his brain the whole time. I say, well, so what? Okay, so I have this, and what do you think of that? Because when somebody's got the knowledge like that, you just want to always get him. So as I'm sad to say, as I mentioned, we are moving out of what has really been a home for the network for exactly 5 years. We moved in here July 24th, 2011. With thanks to many of you, with your help, we sold 1,800 bricks, raised $250,000 to build this studio. It ended up costing us $1.25 million. So that's fine. I put in a million. You put in a quarter of a million.
But it took the edge off.
And incidentally, we paid it off within 2 years. Again, thanks to your help financially, and it's been a really great home for us. However, as I mentioned, there's a new owner to the building, and they decided they wanted to turn this into a beer brewery,
which makes this all very apropos.
I'm telling you, we've already kind of christened it.
Right.
Whew, it smells like a brewery in here. But I'm sad to say we are moving. But the good news is when we designed this, as you do always with a studio, as you know, you design it to be portable, to be movable. No studio is permanent. Even if you think you're going to stay in the building, you're going to change it over time. So all of this is can come down. None of this is solid, is real. It's all going to come with us. So we are moving into a new studio. We will be there in 1 week. Our first show will be a week from tomorrow, the first twit. And so you'll see the new studio. It'll be a little rough, just as it's a little rough around here right now as we start to move things out. Pieces are starting to come down. In fact, as soon as we finish this show, this whole, we call this Radio Corner because it's got the mixer that I cut my teeth on when I was in college. It's got my ham radio gear. It's got our Collins AM transmitter. All of this will be going down and moving over to the new studio. We thought we'd ask the staff who's worked here, sometimes happily, sometimes not, for the last 5 years, what their memories are of the Twit Brick House. Take a look.
Hi. Tell me one of your most fond memories of the Brick House.
Oh, fond memories?
One of my favorite moments actually had nothing to do with me, but it makes me laugh every time I see it, is when Leo and the Twit Gang gathered around the round table and did the Harlem Shake. It's a reality that I have to work around that broken table every single week. Thank you, Leo.
Well, right now, Patrick's got the giant gear over his head. That was kind of cool. You should go check it out. Did you see him already? Come on, let's go. He's got the gear.
One of my fondest memories being here at the Brick House has to be the time I went away on vacation and came back to my desk and my computer and my monitors and everything I owned covered in aluminum foil. Just everything covered in aluminum foil. Jerks.
Probably my first day. I've only ever been in the Brick House. And my first day was Halloween. So it was fun because I got to meet everybody. And then my next day was Tuesday, like 3 days later. So I got to meet everybody and be like, who are you? Oh yeah, Jerry, you're the unicorn. Oh, Anthony the Joker. So that was pretty cool.
I guess it's the sound of ice shaking. Sound of ice shaking around 2 o'clock when people start drinking cocktails and I can't because I still have a show to do.
Was that time that Josh took his pants off at my desk. My desk was the no pants zone, and Josh took it literally.
Wait, Alex said what?
My favorite memory of the Brick House would have to be back from the days when we were doing Game On. Once a week, we'd stay up till 2 a.m., eating pizza, playing video games, doing stupid stuff. Most of those memories are best left unremembered, but definitely had a lot of fun, and those were the early days of my employment at the Brick House.
I liked it when I got my own office, so I could shut people out.
I was working late. There was like only one or two of us in here, and we thought someone had broken in. And we were like super scared, and then it was just Burke.
One of them that stands out is when I interviewed Rob Lynch on Mavericks, and he filled our entire kitchen with Arby's, and Chad ate like 15 sandwiches. Yeah, that was pretty funny.
Jeez.
Yeah, I heard what you said in your response. Your fond memory of the Brick House.
Real fond memory.
I don't remember that. I would remember that. But I don't
remember. We moved into the Brick House studio and walked down the street in a little parade, and we're all very happy and proud, and it's a very emotional day.
I also like sneaking the raccoon into almost every show.
Wait a minute! Is that a raccoon?
My fondest memory was the first time I ever walked into the Brick House back in 2013. I was just going to be doing some fill-in, and I thought, oh, wow, I'd love to work here. And now I work here every day.
So my favorite memory of the Twit Brick House is from our 24-hour benefit for UNICEF, when we did a podcast for 24 hours, and we had different acts. And in this very kitchen, I taught Chad and Leo how to tap dance.
Speaking of New Year's Eve, I remember it was late in the night and we all got into like pajamas. 3 a.m, crazy. Leo had a tattoo, he had a shaved head, people were doing tomfoolery.
The best memory I have is that was the very first day I worked here, and it was the fact that I was not even here for 20 minutes, and then I don't know who it was, I think it was Tony, just came in and said, here's a camera, and gave it to me, and then I had to stand and film the Apple One computer for 3 hours, and I just wasn't expecting that to be my first day. I expected, I don't know, just it wasn't that.
Brian and I had a space that some people have heard called the No Hole, basically started as a staging area for Know How. And eventually it just became sort of the fun place to be. It was the parlor. We had everything from the arcade machine to a nice beanbag where we could take a nap to the desk where we actually did get occasionally, once in a while, some work done.
My favorite memory was the basement before Padre and Brian moved down and started the No Hole. It was all mine, all of it.
I'd have to say my favorite moment from being here at the Brick House would have to be wearing pants every day to work. Every day, pants on. I never took my pants off at work. In fact, you know who did? Leo did. When I was TDing the Gizmos once, he took off his pants and walked around. I swear it happened. It was crazy. What you looking at? Oh, hey, Jerry.
Hey,
Macon.
I'm just going to the lounge.
Ah, you guys! Oh, that's so great.
That was good.
Thank you so much to Jerry. Who else put that together? And Anthony?
That was Anthony.
Anthony Nielsen who shot that. Well done. You're going to make me cry. We have had a lot of fun here. It's been great. Your guys, Pixel Corps, also here most of the time and had a lot of fun. I'm glad you could be here for our last screensavers.
It's an honor to be here.
And we launched the screensaver. We brought the new screensavers back. We couldn't have done that if we weren't in this large...
I don't think it would have fit in the little house.
Would not have fit in the cottage. Where we're going, even better. You're going to love it. And you will see a lot more of that next week on the new screensavers. Thank you. By the way, that day where I was walking around naked, that was Tanya's second day on the job. What did you think? That was just like the way it is around here?
She thought it was going to work out. Yeah. He's not really walking
around in this. The funny thing is, I wasn't inside. I was outside.
Right. Yeah.
They didn't really think it was that funny in the Petaluma Police Department. All right, let's walk over here. I want to say hi to David Glickman, old friend. He's the founder of a new company that has a new take on ad blockers, OurData.us. David, it's nice to see you.
Great to see you again.
Sorry you're here as we're tearing the place down. I apologize about the crime scene tape.
No problem.
Behind you.
What a good episode to be on.
Yeah.
Little whiskey and a little bit of memory lane.
You know, please have some if you want. It's all over there.
I've been over here having it.
I called it an ad blocker, but I think it's a lot more. Tell us what our data is all about.
Yeah, so thanks again for having me on.
Sure.
You're right, it's more than an ad blocker. In fact, we actually, the goal here is to be an ad enabler. And let me explain that. What I'm going to do is just show a few visuals to help you get a sense of what we're focused on at our data. So I think your viewers will see this. And just a really, really quick, speaking of memory lane, just to think about advertising and the world of advertising. Before the internet, you relatively had this balance. And the balance was that for my attention as a consumer, I would actually be able to get content, right? So before
the
internet.
That was fair trade.
That's
right.
Crazy.
Relatively fair trade, and as you can see there, the consumers are happy in the advertising.
Right. I'd read Herb Cain in the San Francisco Chronicle right next to a Macy's ad. I'd see the ad. I'd read Herb Cain. Everybody was happy.
Yeah, and generally everybody was happy, exactly. Then you entered this notion of data collection, right? And so we all know it. The best example of this we've all experienced is that you shop online for a pair of shoes, and then all of a sudden you see shoes all over the place on all the different sites you have.
For me, it's mostly video cameras.
Yes.
Lots. I can only imagine.
There's little video cameras everywhere, all the time. My world is the video cameras.
So the ring doorbell, everything, you have it all over the web.
Yeah.
And that actually created an imbalance, if you think about it, because as users, we were giving away not only our attention now, but our data.
More than our attention.
More than our attention.
Yeah.
And so you can see consumers a little bit unhappy.
Right.
Advertising industry super happy.
Right.
We think the scales went the wrong way when you entered ad blocking. And you talked about this earlier in the program.
Now we get everything for free.
Now.
Give them neither.
as a consumer, I'm blocking ads. As you said, this is hard for publishers to actually make a living if you have that experience where that's happening. And so this is what we're trying to fix. And we believe that our data restores the balance. How do we restore it? You can see now that the bubbles are even on each side. And the reason the bubbles are even is that our data is an enabler. It's an ad enabler, because what we're asking people to do, and publishers and advertisers to do, is compensate people for what is the most valuable asset that all of us have, which is our data.
Right.
So by sharing a little bit of our data, we're really focused on choice. This is all about a consumer choosing what they want to do. And in this sense, the choice is, if I want ads, I would love to have ads, but give me a little bit of compensation for that data that I'm sharing
get
with you.
Paid for get the paid data for sharing I'm giving the data.
Okay. Okay, well, why would publishers and advertisers want to do that? Well, here's the challenge. Today, ad blockers make it so you can't get any ads to your consumers. And you guys talked about this Facebook war going on before. Right. And that's just a road to nowhere. It's just going to be a battle back and forth, back and forth. Well, as a publisher, you would rather get the majority of the income that you make today on advertising, share a little bit with the community, rather than get nothing. And I mentioned the word community. One of the things, and Leo and I talked about this before when we were catching up about our data, we actually created it as a public benefit corporation.
It's not a for-profit company.
It is a for-profit. Yeah. So public benefit corporations, great examples are Patagonia, Ben & Jerry's Ice Cream, Etsy, the
community. So they're not nonprofits.
They're not nonprofits, but they are driven by a corporate mission that's not just about profits.
And they're is there a tax requirement that they give back a certain amount of the profit, or how does
there actually is not a requirement to give back, but a great question, because we've actually set up our data to give back 90% of the profits that we create. So here's how it works. I'm going to show you and the viewers the app. The way that it works is you download our data.
You install this. Is iPhone only right now?
Currently, it's iPhone only. Okay. We're coming out with a Chrome extension for desktop as well as Android.
And iPhone treats this as one of the ad blockers. So you enable ad blocking once you've installed this.
We can show people that if we have time. And you enable ad blocking. And the idea is, the sooner you sign up, and one of the reasons I asked to be on the show, if you were interested, as early as possible in the days of
you're just launching.
Data. We're just launching. And the whole idea is, when you launch, similar to the Cleveland Whiskey team.
Right.
When you launch, when you download our data, you get shares. We call them membership shares. The sooner you sign up, the more shares you're going to get, because you're helping grow the community.
Right.
Then we're now in the process of talking to publishers and saying, hey, if someone comes along and is blocking ads, why don't you encourage them to use our data? Because by doing so, we enable ads to come through. Advertisers eventually will pay a small portion of that. We distribute all that money to the community. And the way we know how much to distribute is, the sooner you sign up and the more you share it, the more shares you get in our data. And so you can see here, my screen went to black there. You can see here, this is just an example, the estimated value of your shares. If we have 300 members right now in this version of the app. If we get to 10,000, the value of your shares is going to grow. Well, how do I get more shares? How do I create more value? It's very simple. We've all had these experiences. You share your referral code. And by doing so, every time you get people to sign up, you get a few more shares. People sometimes ask, well, how does that work? Is that fair? Well, we think it's really fair, because the people early on who help grow this community for all of us get a little bit more.
And it's a way for you to pyramid your business to get more and more people to use it. You've got to spread the word.
We've got to spread the word, and everybody gets shares. So there's no penalty for being later. There's just an advantage for being earlier.
So I'm still going to get ads, in other words, with your ad blocker.
You now have choice. Okay. It's all about choice.
So I can say I don't want ads?
You can say you don't want ads.
Yeah.
But what we found as we talked to more and more people is, when given a choice of either getting ads but being compensated for it, and understanding that you're being part of this balancing of the ecosystem.
Right.
When we talk to people, people get it. They're like, yeah, publishers need to make a living. We want to support publishers, but we don't think it's fair, because that balances out. So it's all about choice. And so if you choose to show ads, then you're going to get compensated for that.
Am I going to get a check?
Eventually, you will get compensated through the app.
Okay.
Probably won't be a check, just like PayPal and other places where you set up an account.
But I'll get money.
You'll get money.
Okay. Now, and there's a charity element to this as well.
Thank you for asking. There is a charity element, and I'll put it up.
Because I may not look at if I get $20, big deal. But if I could donate that to my charity, I might even feel better about this.
I mean, for me, if I could attach this to Kiva,
there you go. I would
much prefer just have all that, because right now I have like a Kiva account that's just constantly turning, you know, of stuff. Yep.
That's a micro lending.
Micro lending in Africa and all of this.
Yeah, we know Kiva.
Big thing for Alex. Right now it's the Susan G. Komen Foundation.
Exactly. So we launched with a partner, the Susan G. Komen Breast Cancer Research and Support Foundation. And so today, if you actually put in Komen SF, Komen is actually getting those shares. So the two of you are exactly right. When we talk to people, there's generally two choices people make. Either, hey, I do want some of the money, mm-hmm. or I would love to support a charity.
Right.
It can be Komen, but you could tomorrow literally mm-hmm. just sign up, have Kiva sign up and put in their code, and then spread the word here's our data. Yeah. Please support Kiva because I'm passionate about Kiva.
Right.
So hopefully your viewers can go do that right now.
So you could do it either way. You could get a payout, or you could say, let's give it to charity.
Exactly.
Is there a setting in there that says, I don't feel like seeing ads today, maybe tomorrow? Or is if I use our data, am I going to always see the ads, but it's just going to get some money in the account?
Yeah, so you have to commit to turning it on so that you see ads.
Right.
Right? So you can't turn it. We don't want people to turn it off and then turn it on and turn it on.
Well, because they'll turn it off and forget, probably. Yeah.
But they have the choice. It all comes back to choice.
And when I see the ads, do I only see the ads for the advertisers that are participating in your program?
Yes. So you will.
So it'll block everything else.
The whole idea is that we want to work with publishers to say, here's an ecosystem that can balance it.
Not advertisers, publishers.
The publishers.
Yes.
But if the publisher's not participating, it just blocks all the ads.
Correct. That's where.
So if I turn the ad blocker on, and I come to Twit, if Twit is participating, then I see all the ads.
Otherwise,
and
you get don't points. See
Otherwise, I don't see them at all.
Correct. Is that correct?
Yep. Correct.
Interesting. So you know that every ad you're seeing, there's going to be a tit for tat. There's going to be.
Right. That's the vision we have, is to try to get.
I like
it. It comes back to that balance, right?
Right.
So that we make it fair for all involved. And the whole idea here was that we saw the race there is just not fair. It doesn't give consumers choice. And even if you look at the people in the industry, they're all realizing they've tried these different things of getting people
to pay. It's very binary. It either you got it or you don't have it, right? I do Google Contributor, which replaces some Google ads with either blank, or I use Kitty Cats. Mm-hmm. And then I pay them $10 up to $10 a month, and they divvy that out to the publishers. But I like this better. This is a little bit more, I don't know why, but it feels a little more fair.
That's the whole idea, is fair and consumer choice. And then the other thing
I'm seeing the ad. I shouldn't,
Yeah, the other thing I should mention is it doesn't cost anything. So people, it's in your best interest to sign up right away because you get more shares. The other thing that's super important to point out is anybody can sign up today. Meaning, even though we don't have the Chrome extension quite yet and the Android quite yet, you just go to ourdata.us and you sign up. So you get your place in line. So everybody can get their place in line right away, either for themselves or for Kiva or whatever.
Right. I think I'm much more engaged with the idea that if Kiva is getting the money that
wouldn't that give you
that it builds up my feeling? I'd be like, I'll see those ads.
I don't mind seeing those ads. Somebody's getting some benefit from it.
Exactly.
It is out though for iPhone, and I can download that at the App Store now.
You can download it at the App Store now, but you can go to ourdata.us and anybody can sign up.
Okay.
So the whole idea is we need to get as many people signed up for this to work. That balance that I showed,
That way
we
when you
need
go,
your viewers.
I mean, really, it's like 10,000 is fine, but what you really need is a million.
Right. Because then you go to publishers
and you have 11.
There's all these people that aren't going to be
publishers signed up?
We have, actually, we were talking about this before. This coming week, we have a bunch of different meetings. We've talked to a lot of publishers, and now, actually, this coming week, we have a few that were almost there. I can't say who they are yet, but we're almost there and being able to launch with it.
Well, if we can help, I really want to help.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Everybody downloading it. Yeah. And actually, again, just sign up if you don't want to download yet, just so you get your place in line.
OurData.us.
Yep.
You could sign up now. You could choose whether it goes to Susan G. Komen or whether at some point you get a payout. But sign up now to get the maximum benefit.
And watching live, just wait a little while so I can get
mine. One last thing is when you sign up, once you start sharing it, as soon as you hit sharing it with 5 people and they register with your code and then multiply that, just keep going, you get more and more shares. and eventually your friends that you've shared with get more and more shares. Great. So it's this effect that we're trying to get going so that we get the critical mass. You're exactly right. We need that critical mass, and it's the viewers like yours that are going to help us get there.
David Glickman is a serial entrepreneur. When he told me about this, I was very excited. I said, as soon as you've got this launched, and this was some time ago, please let us know so we can put you on the new screensavers and tell the world. Everybody, this is a great opportunity to kind of redress the imbalance between advertisers, publishers, and us as readers. And
it's all about fairness and choice. Yes,
exactly. Thank you,
right.
David.
Thank really you. Great to see you.
Nice to see you.
Thank
OurData.us. Padre just got back from DEF CON, and one of the highlights at DEF CON is the badges. He's got a retrospective of some of the best badges from DEF CON conferences past. Take a look.
This year, more than 22,000 people attended DEF CON 24 in Las Vegas, Nevada. DEF CON is a curious mix of security researchers, hackers, makers, and those who just want to see below the veneer of the information society. While it's easy to be overwhelmed, especially by the coveted Uber badge competitions, where the prize is lifetime entry to DEF CON and the admiration of your peers, DEF CON is famous for having something for everyone. And for the maker, there is no better place than the Hardware Hacking Village and the EFF Badge Hacking Pageant. This year, there were three categories: Analog, Past DEF CON Digital, and Wildcard. Let's take a look at the entries. A popular analog entry was the forging of last year's Uber badge, made by Grandmaker Lost and given only to the most elite of contest winners. No fewer than five individuals attempted to recreate the radioactive glass, custom-forged metal, and Lichtenberg etching on the DEF CON 23 Uber badge. For reference, here is the real DC 23 Uber badge. Most of these were created with the makers only having pictures of the originals, so this was no easy task, and all of them made decent copies right down to the iridescent marble. Other analog entries included this DEF CON 13 badge turned into a lockpick set, and a top hat made from last year's vinyl record badge. The vinyl badge was a playable record that had content needed to complete the DEF CON crypto challenge, and of course, some pretty good music. The real treat in the badge hack pageant was digitally hacking past DEF CON badges, and this year there were some pretty good ones. This is a clock made from a DC 23 vinyl badge, some LEDs, an embedded processor, and a bunch of tape. This one of my favorites, is a DC 22 badge with a wireless receiver, upgraded power source, and two continuous rotation servos that made a remote control vehicle. It used the onboard badge processor, a propeller, and was coded to speak PWM. However, my absolute favorite was this DC-22 badge that was turned into a rat's nest breathalyzer. Using an alcohol sensor, essentially a fuel cell, the team used a little electronic ingenuity to turn the analog output from the sensor into digital input that the badge could understand. Of course, it's not just DEF CON badges in the pageant. The last category was Wildcard, which included everything else. This is a badge with a ring of WS2812 LEDs that can be controlled via a smartphone app. And there were not one, but two, Bender Bending Rodriguez badges that did everything from scan the wireless environment to giving Bender a cigar and the ability to display audio frequencies. In the end, the pageant is one of my favorite parts of DEF CON because it requires makers to create things on site with whatever materials they can find, borrow, and disassemble. If you ever find yourself at a DEF CON, take a seat in the Hardware Hacking Village, ask a bunch of questions from the geeks around you, and get creating.
I think we've got beer brewing in our Pico Brew. In just a bit, we're going to talk to the folks from Pico Brew about this desktop, not publishing, not printing, brewing.
Well, it's kind of like printing. Printing beer.
Yeah, printing beer. Desktop brewing in just a bit. First, though, a word from our desktop printer, Epson. I love my Epson printer, and I've been using Epson printers, I bet you have too, since the very earliest days. My first computer, an Epson MX80, remember, dot matrix and FX80. And of course, over time, I've got Epson inkjets, Epson lasers. The Epson photo printers are still second to none. Right?
I have some big Epson
printers.
And they are the best.
They do black and white monochrome prints like no one else can. These guys know their business. They created the Precision Core engine for their industrial printing, 40 million picoliter dots per second. Give you really crisp printing. They give you beautiful, vivid colors. They give you two-sided printing, no warm-up time. It's just, it's all the benefits of inkjet. And now they've taken it one step farther. They've put that precision core engine into the Eco Tank printer. Take a look at this. Is the one we just bought for the house. Actually, Lisa just got a second one for her office. The ET4550 Epson Eco Tank printer. It doesn't have ink cartridges. It comes with a tank and 2 years of ink in the box. So when we got the 4550, I opened it up.
2 years?
2 years. There were little bottles of ink. I poured the ink into the tank. It's enough ink to print 11, for this printer, not this printer, but the 4550, 11,000 black pages, 8,000 color pages. It's about 50 ink cartridges worth. So that means you're not going to be buying new ink for this printer until the year 2018.
Unless you print like me, and then you've
well,
got
maybe
it for
sooner, but it's a
months.
Lot of pages. They also, well, for you, you should get the bigger, the workforce printer.
Absolutely.
For the small office, that has 20,000 pages of black or color printing in the box. In the box. That's the beauty part. And when it's time to buy new ink, you're going to save a lot of money. It's about 80% less expensive buying it in these bottles or packets if you're going to use
it. Because a lot of it's the technology that required for those.
The ink is inexpensive. It does everything like the two-sided printer. It's got a 30-page auto document feeder. It's a great all-in-one printer. Prints wirelessly from tablets and phones. It really is the new way to print. No wonder it won the 2016 Small Biz Windows Printer of the Year Award, the CES 2016 Innovation Award. It is, you know, it's the printer industry doing the right thing. I want you to check it out. Epson.com/ecotank. By the way, it's not the printer industry. It's Epson. Epson's the only one doing this. I imagine the other guys are going, gosh darn you, Epson. Gosh darn you, you're undermining our business model. Epson.com/ecotank. EPSON.com/ecotank. We thank Epson for making great printers for my whole computing life and, frankly, for inventing even better the Epson EcoTank printers. Epson.com/ecotank. So it's brewing. You can hear it. On the line with us, Jim Mitchell. He's the chief scientific officer and co-founder of Pico Brew. He started it with his brother. Hey, Jim.
Hello.
Nice to see you.
Yeah, good to be with you.
Now, you did something earlier called the Zymatic. Tell me about that.
Yeah, the Zymatic was the first product we made. Came about because my brother was home brewing. Made a very nice beer. But couldn't duplicate it.
That's the problem, isn't it? It's such a chaotic recipe that it's different every time.
Right.
Yeah.
And so he called me to see if we could make. It actually started out more like a brew cart, where we make the whole process automated, so that you can get duplicating beer. So
reproducible quality.
I mean, yeah, because I tried it many years ago, and I have to admit, I made a couple batches of beer, and the first one was amazing, which is the only reason I made two and three, which were not as amazing.
Well, Russell, our IT guy, is an accomplished home brewer, but he has spent literally tens of thousands of dollars to get just the right equipment and very reliable thermometers. I guess temperature's really critical in all of this. This, poor Russell, this simplifies the whole process. So when you made the Zymatic, what's the difference now in the Pico Brew? Tell me about that.
So Zymatic is a pro unit. Infinitely flexible, can make everything. The Pico unit is a kit-based one. We're signing up. We've got over 100 breweries that have given us their recipes.
What? Oh, so you could duplicate a favorite beer?
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
That's interesting. And
that's the point, so that you can have a beer from a brewery that's on the other side of the country. And it'll be fresh as though you were sitting at their tasting room.
Now, so. Do I have to go grocery shopping, or are you going to give me the ingredients? How's that going to work?
They come in a Pico pack, is what we call them.
This is a Pico pack here, right?
Yep.
And how much is a typical Pico pack?
It depends on the recipe.
Mm-hmm.
So that one you have there is... I want to say it's about $15, $16.
And how much beer am I going to get?
You get 5 liters of beer, which is about 13 beers.
That's nice. Okay. So it's cheaper than buying the beer.
A little bit more than a buck a beer.
But it's fun to make.
Oh, inside, yeah.
Now, we unsealed this because you would keep this sealed, and you actually just pop these into the Pico Brew.
Correct.
Because it's like a, it's all a contained thing. But we unsealed it to just to, so this is the mash, right? That's mostly barley?
Yep, mostly barley.
But other things.
And then
you also get a,
yep.
This is the yeast. Now, of course, yeast is critical to any kind of alcohol manufacture. And this yeast came from, is this from a brewery, this particular one, the B52?
No, that's a common, well, breweries use Cefal yeast, but that size packet is very common in homebrew.
Okay.
You can also have the choice to use one of the liquid yeasts from White Labs.
Oh, you can use it. Okay, so that's good. So, and then it also has, this is very important, sugar, because this is why we kick it all off, right?
Right.
We feed the little yeasties, and then they start finding, they find the mash, and then we start getting alcohol. There's another packet here. What's this second packet for?
Oh, that's the hops cartridge.
Oh, so you have a mash cartridge and a hops cartridge. And then there's different amounts of hops or different kinds of hops in here.
Right.
And when you order this kit, so if I'm going to order the blonde B52, I'm going to get these two boxes and then all these little packets, right?
Correct.
Got it.
Oh, those hops smell so good.
They smell very hoppy.
Oh, my goodness. Now, this isn't a very particularly hoppy beer, so we only have a few packets of hop in here. But if you were making an IPA, a very hoppy beer, you'd have more hops in here.
Oh, it would be packed.
Oh, packed with hops.
Yep.
Just what Paul Thurrott's wanting all his life. So we actually started the process. Is this a B52 we're making? What are we making?
That's Tweedy's, so that's a wheat beer.
Oh, I love wheat beer. I love wheat beer. So what's going on right now?
Right now you're in the mash step. So there's it's a two-step mash on this one. So it's basically extracting the sugars out of the grain.
By washing it or cooking it or?
No, the grain is full of starch. And starch is glucose. Chains of glucose molecules, and you've got enzymes active at various temperatures, and it's basically breaking down the starch into sugars.
Jim, I get the feeling you might have a background in chemistry.
Chemistry, physics, mostly.
And you built this from scratch? I mean, does anybody make anything like this? Could you use somebody else's parts?
Not really. We had to get pretty innovative in this. It goes through six different areas, fluid flow in there, and so we had to actually invent a special valve to do that in a very small form factor.
Now I've been to the Coors factory. Those vats are gigantic.
This is the family vat.
This is the family vat.
Yeah, exactly.
This is so cool. And they move the beer from vat to vat as they do different processes. Then they stop the yeast from growing at some point. They filter it. You're going to do all of that inside of this one box?
No, you're not going to ferment in there.
Oh, you don't? Okay.
Right now, it's all circulating to and from that keg you have on the side.
Oh, so it's using this. This isn't the...
Right.
Okay.
And it's sterilizing the keg because you're going to go up to boiling temperatures,
right.
too.
Right.
So that's very important so that you don't contaminate your beer. Once it's done, you're just going to seal that keg, set it on the floor where you're going to ferment it, wait for it to cool down overnight, and then pitch your yeast. For that recipe, probably about 3-4 days, and you'll be done with the fermenting. Then you'll hook it back up to the machine and transfer it into the serving keg.
Oh, wow. And you get all of this when you buy your Pico Brew.
Correct.
And you get the little sticker, too, I see.
Oh, yep.
So you have to put a sticker so people know what you're drinking. This is really cool. This was a Kickstarter. How much did you raise on Kickstarter?
I believe it was about $1.3 million.
Wow. And that was enough to fund the development of this?
Yes.
Pretty impressive. How many prototypes did you go through?
Oh, wow.
A lot.
In the lab, I usually work on a wireframe machine so that I can swap out parts, inspect everything 360 degrees. I still have those for various testing. But it's been pretty much locked up with very little changes for about 6 months, 8 months maybe. That's nice.
Did you have a background in brewing beer?
Only home brewing, yeah. But I did have a background in making rice syrup, rice milk, soy milk, grain hydrolysis.
Interesting. So you have some background.
And the Pico Brew is, if you want something that's fairly automatic, I'm going to get something, I'm going to put it in here, I'm going to do a couple things, but not a lot of work. Now, is there still a space? Is the Zymatic still something that you would use if you want to kind of hack it?
Yeah, the Zymatics are going into a lot of breweries as a quality control and R&D device.
Make a small batch.
If I want to play with it, if I really want to play with the idea and play with my mixtures and change my mixtures and do all those things, it sounds like the Zymatic is still the way to go. Whereas if I want to just have some great beer ready when my friends come over, the Pico sounds like a better solution.
Now you don't do this. Go ahead.
So the Pico, you can also change some things.
Okay.
When you started it, it gave you a choice of doing some adjustments. So you can raise or lower the ABV raise and lower the IBUs on that knob. So you can customize each kit.
Right.
And then you also have a option of doing what we call freestyle, where you can design a kit. You start out, say, a base IPA malt. You could change out some of the flavor grains, and then you can change out and substitute different hops.
Interesting.
Who do you see as your audience? I mean, you're not doing it to save money. You're doing it because you love beer, and is it a hobbyist? Is it somebody who wants really good, fresh beer?
This is for the people that really like beer and want to explore all the styles of beer, that would like to taste a Australian brewery beer and have it fresh, be the same as if they were within that country.
I kind of like that idea. Yeah.
Well, and it's also an online community. Where people can brew the beers, then rate them. And since everybody will be drinking the same beer and rating the same beer, then you get better tasting notes, better indications of what that beer really is. And then the breweries can then look and maybe tweak their beer recipe and see if people like that more or less.
I really love this idea. And I'm not a major beer drinker. I bet if I know everybody who really gets into beer ends up trying to make it.
Right.
And sometimes with mixed results. Do you want to try some? We have.
Let's try
so one. What is this? It says half-squeezed IPA. Is this a... What is this?
That is a very hoppy IPA.
Oh, boy.
Right, pull this out?
Pull it out and then turn it.
There you go. It's coming.
I got it.
Oh, that looks good. Oh, this looks really good. And is this from a brewery? Is this a recipe from a brewery or one of your own?
This is one developed on the Zymatic.
Oh, okay. And is there, it looks like there's some orange in it. Oh, it smells like there's some orange in it.
No, that's just grains and hops.
Wow. Oh, it smells fabulous.
So the citrus flavor is from the hops.
Oh, it's delicious. It is delicious. Yeah, it has a very citrusy. And this was made in a Pico Brew.
That was made in the Pico Brew.
It's fresh.
That was made about 2 weeks ago.
That's kind of neat. It's really good. You don't ever want to age this, right? You just want to drink it right out of the...
Actually, there are some beers that you do want to age. We do a Imperial Russian Stout that right now I have aging. It's about 2 months old, one with some cherry wood and one with some oak.
Wow.
It's good. It's very good.
And have you been able to do the Holy Grail, to reach the Holy Grail, where it's just consistent every time? You know you're gonna what you're going to get when you use this.
Yes. Past that benchmark a year and a half ago.
That's great.
Where different machines, same recipe kits, but different sources of the grains from different stores, and brewed three of them and on different days, and they were identical.
I like this.
I'm just waiting for when they have Pliny the Elder, or yeah, more importantly, Pliny
Russell
the,
makes,
the Younger.
Russell makes Pliny.
Oh, does he?
Yeah, he makes a Pliny clone.
We'd love to sign him up.
Get Russian, yeah, Russian we would River love brewer, brewery. Yeah. Well, how do breweries react? I mean, don't they say, well, no, that's our private secret recipe?
Actually, it's all across the board. Some think it's great because if they don't have coverage, we right, give them worldwide exposure.
Right.
And if it's a great beer, you're going to want to actually visit the brewery.
Sure.
At some
Pliny the Elder doesn't have coverage of Petaluma. It's only right, like 10 minutes away.
It's actually good for the brewery.
Yep.
Yeah.
Right.
And
so
they
cool,
get a royalty off of every kit.
Right. No, that's fantastic. I love the idea of being able to have, you know, I definitely could see how the network, as it got bigger, you know, you'd be able to German beers and French beers and Belgian beers and all kinds of other things that you're just not going to ever get fresh, you know, unless you go there.
So here's the really good news. We've talked about all this. It's under $700. That's amazing. I mean, this is a really nice piece of gear. You must barely be breaking even on this thing. That is wonderful.
We do a nice job of design.
You sure do. Look at that. This is the Apple computer of beer makers.
It is. It
really,
definitely,
really nice.
It just works.
Jim Mitchell is chief scientific officer and co-founder with his brother of Pico Brew. We are brewing. And how long before we get beer out of this thing?
That one, you'll get the hot wort in the keg about 2 hours, 15 minutes. Then just follow the instructions, plug the keg, let it cool overnight where you're going to ferment it, pitch the yeast, and then towards the end of next week, you'll be drinking a good beer.
Just in time for the move.
Started the brew in the old one.
And we'll end
and you'll
it in
drink
the new
it
one.
In the new one.
You don't want this back right away, do you, Jim?
Keep it.
No, why not? Why not? Careful. Keep it for a little while. I don't want to keep it forever. Thank you. Hey, Jim, it's really nice to meet you. Cheers. And thank you for the Pico Brew. Where can we find out more? PicoBrew.com?
PicoBrew.com.
Awesome. $6.99. I think there's a lot of beer lovers.
Oh, yeah.
If you've ever tried to make beer, you can waste a lot more money than that and make a terrible brew.
I've done that. I tell you with experience that I would have just done this.
I'm not even a beer lover. This is delicious.
This is really good beer.
It's good beer.
Yep.
All right, we're going to take a break, and when we come back, we've got our questions from the mailbag. But first, Megan Morrone will show you how to take secure notes on your iPhone. Cheers.
In the past few years, I've put my stylish collection of tinfoil hats on the shelf. I'm pretty much an open book about most things, but on occasion, even I worry about the amount of private and financial information I keep on my iPhone. Like when you travel, it's a good idea to keep photos of your driver's license or password for emergencies, but if someone got access to your iPhone, you would not want anyone to also have access to those photos. I suggest that you secure your most private things on your iPhone in a note with a password. This isn't a new feature of iOS 10 either. As long as you have iOS 9.3, you can start using this feature right now. Open Notes, create a note, tap the Share button, and then tap Lock Note. Secure with Touch ID or a password. Make sure to tap the lock icon to lock the note. To add a picture, open Photos, tap the Share button, tap Add to Notes, add some text, tap Save, then Open Notes. Here's what it looks like if a looky-loo tries to see it. Pro tip, the text you write at the top of the note can be seen by anyone who opens your note app. I'm Megan Morrone, and I host iOS Today every Monday and Tech News Today with Jason Howell every Monday through Friday.
It's time for the mailbag. Here we go. Welcome. Oh, my God. The thing is smoking. We must have some smoking hot mail in here. Either that or they're trying to burn the studio down before we leave.
Scorched earth policy.
Whoa. Jeez Louise. Here's the mail. Oh. And this is my R2-D2 hat, which I'm going to wear to... wear today in honor of Kenny Baker, who passed, I think, this week. He is, of course, the guy in the R2-D2 suit, the most famous robot in history. He was 81 years old. Here's a mailbag. You take one, I take one, but I think they're really both for you. Why don't you start?
All right. So my question is from Ian. For many years, I worked freelance as a video editor, but left in 2010 to move into a different career path. I now work in the decorative concrete industry.
What?
In the marketing and tech support side.
What is the decorative concrete industry?
Oh, it's like it's custom concrete that goes on the side of highways and buildings and everything else. Oh. Separating
walls.
Maybe I
should have built the studio with decorative concrete. That would have lasted forever.
No comment.
Yeah.
We have expanded our department and are now going to be producing and editing our own content. My question is, what editing platform do you recommend?
Oh, well, there's the guy.
He said 15-inch MacBook Pro with Final Cut 10, Windows-based laptop with Adobe Premiere Pro, and then also what HD camera in the $1,000 to $2,000 range.
Okay, I'm going to answer it with incomplete and foolish knowledge, and then you can give us the voice of wisdom. I'd say get that Mac Pro and Final Cut, and then go to Blackmagic and choose one of their amazing cameras. Easily you can get under the $2,000 range, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so there's a couple different options with a lot of these things. I definitely would go with the Final Cut 10 approach. I think that Final Cut 10 is
really
built
for you. It got a bad rap.
Well, so when it started, there was a lot of things that weren't in it when it first came out that were in the old one, and people got upset about that, and then they moved on. And it wasn't very scalable when it came out. It was hard to, you couldn't run it on a large scalable, drive system and have lots of computers tied into it. Most of that has all been handled at this point, and what we're seeing is they keep on innovating it. This keeps on getting better and better and better. And the crazy thing is that no one up until now has been charged for an upgrade. So if you bought it early on, you're seeing all these upgrades for free. The big thing is that it scales with whatever Mac you're using. So we're using it with 4K. It is, if we had bigger footage, it would handle it. It just simply works, And so it's very fast. One of our partners went and they actually had Adobe, Avid, and Apple come in and show them. They said, we have to do the fastest turnarounds. Train our guys, and we'll see which one will work the best. And Final Cut was the winner. So I think that you're going to find for fast turnaround, for quick processing, you're going to find that Final Cut 10 is probably the best solution.
Especially
there are
for
reasons,
a small shop.
There
right?
are reasons to use Final Cut Premiere. If you're already using After Effects, you're going to find that the integration between After Effects and Premiere and sometimes Photoshop is going to be better than Final Cut 10. So
you almost have
that's
to decide
the
if you're an Adobe shop or an Apple shop,
yeah.
right? And at that point, you're all in on one or the other.
Absolutely. And yeah. so we use After Effects and then put it into Final Cut as well, but the integration is much tighter.
Yeah.
So I think
yeah.
that, I think, but I would choose Final Cut 10. I'm a big Final Cut 10 user. The HD camera, there's a couple different options there.
Under
2,000. So the thing you want to look at is kind of whether you want to go into 4K and whether you want to, so one option is, and we have a lot of these little micros. I don't know if you've seen the little, there are these tiny little Blackmagic micro cameras. And we probably have 10 or 12 of those guys. And they are like $1,200 each, 4K, 4/3-inch sensor. And they keep on growing. There's a lot of ways to hack them, which is we use them for live production because we can, hack the camera. And so the geeky approach is one of these. Now, the problem you're going to be missing with that is you're going to pay $1,200 for that. You don't have a monitor for it. So so then you end up, needing to get a lens. You need to get an external monitor there.
Does it use Micro Four Thirds lenses?
It uses Micro Four Thirds lenses.
Which is nice because there's a really big range of those lenses and at a broad variety of prices, right?
Absolutely. And yeah. and I have to say that the images are really luscious coming out of it. If you go down to 1080p, you're not taking a subsample of the chip. It's actually scaling the 4K image down to 1080p or 720, which makes it look even smoother. It's super compact, really easy to use. The one drawback, again, is that you're not going to have a monitor for it, so you're going to need to get a monitor in addition to that Black Magic makes one. We use a bunch of the video devices monitors, which are a little bit more expensive, but give us some more tools. If you decide you're going to go into, you know, live or anything else, you can control these cameras, the shading, the color, and so on and so forth from the switcher, which is why we use a lot of them. There you can see in this here, the video assist, the little monitor that you can get with it that you can attach to it. We buy little cages. Wooden Camera makes little cages that we put on all of these that work really well. So that's a great little camera. The thing you want to look at, though, is that this is a little bit of a science project as far as a camera goes. We like it because it's infinitely scalable and flexible. Yeah. If you decide that what you really want is just an ENG, you know, solution, the other way to look at it is there's a lot of Sony cameras. We're partial when we're not using Blackmagic cameras. We probably have 15 of both of these. But we have Sony cameras. There's a lot of Sony cameras in the sub-2000 range. I think it's the NFX or NX, series. I can't think of all the acronyms that Sony puts on them, but there's a couple of them that live in the sub-$2,000 range. The one thing I would recommend is that you get a camera that has BNC out, STI out, not just HDMI. HDMI can be, if you're pulling into any kind of system, HDMI is just not a very stable connection. And so getting some kind of BNC solution, in my opinion,
that's
is the way
you're
to go.
Doing, but if he's just shooting it as a movie, you just shoot in the camera, right?
Exactly.
You don't need any output from the camera.
But eventually what ends up happening is you start that way, and then you wish that you had something.
And here
you can see these NX, you can see these cameras, some of these cameras in the $1,600, $1,700. Yeah. These are very solid cameras. Some of these are, now these are one-inch cameras, and then there's a couple of them that Sony makes that are right at the 2,000 range that are 35, super 35 imagers. And I just can't remember the name
so
of this
funny,
one.
So funny, because the consumer camcorder market has disappeared. These are really...
Well, these are very high quality for what you're, for what you're
for
paying
for. Price.
You know,
yeah.
The NEX VG900, that was the one I was looking for. So the NEX VG900 is one of the ones that I've been looking at taking into the field because it's got a 35 mil, super 35 sensor, which is going to give you shorter depth of field, and oftentimes better low light solutions.
But that's almost $3,000. So that's expensive.
Okay, well, I just saw it here. That's interesting. It's listed at $3,000, but I'm seeing it here at $2,000.
Okay.
So I think that I might
shop
be looking
around.
At something. So look around a little bit. But in that range, I think that you may find some solutions. Again, I use a ton. We probably use more Black Magics than anything else. But if you're looking for, you guys are kind of geeky, and you like the ideas of interchangeable lenses. What we like is we can actually hack into the camera.
Right.
If you're not going to hack into the camera, get an ENG style camera that's going to be kind of all in one and not require so much of a science project.
Yeah. There you go. That's some really good information. I mean, straight from the horse's mouth. I mean, this is a guy who works in this every single day. I'm impressed with the Blackmagic, but you're right. That takes more effort on your part.
It does. For when you're doing live stuff and you're doing things that no one's ever done before and you have to hack it and you want a great image, I really
if you're just going out and taking a picture of somebody's patio, maybe get the Sony camera. That'd be easier. Okay, here's a question from Taylor. You're going to have to help me on this one, too. I'm trying to find a media converter that converts iTunes movies that has, MV4 format to MP4. All the ways I've tried online include buying an expensive tool. Is there anywhere else to do this? I got to point out right up front that the reason you're finding this difficult to do is because of copy protection.
Right.
So all the, not music anymore, but all the video, TV and movies that you buy on iTunes have DRM, Digital Right Management, copy protection in there. And that's what's thwarting you converting it.
Because what you want to do is, of course, run it on a device that it wasn't designed to run
right.
on, right?
And Apple and you've noticed this, by the way, that you can only play it on an Apple TV or an Apple computer with iTunes.
Mm.
Now, I should point out that, even though it's illegal, there are things that you can go out and buy that would strip out the copy protection of this thing. For instance, I've heard that there are places on Amazon that you could go where they sell boxes. They don't label them, but they're made in China, that are HDMI converters. That you put an HDMI in, you're playing it back from iTunes or your Apple TV, you just play the video back. It's not converting it to analog, it's just playing it back out of the other side at analog. And for some reason, I don't understand why, it just strips the copy protection right out of the thing. Whoa! who labeled this HTCP stripper? They will never ever say that.
Right, because what that technically is a splitter. It's an HDMI
splitter. See, it's a splitter. Now, how do you know which ones will strip it out or not? Well, you just have to kind of.
Most of them are not very expensive.
This is $20.
Right. Now,
once you've done that, you've got a digital copy and you can just use anything.
Well, but you still have to have something to record it.
Yeah, well, so. You're right. You're going to take it out of the Apple TV into a computer.
Right.
And something then, with HDMI recording. A camcorder would work.
And you could do a camcorder. You could do
capture card.
Again, if we go back to Blackmagic, Blackmagic makes a little thing called a mini recorder.
Yeah.
And a mini recorder is a Thunderbolt to.
Well, you did say this was expensive.
Well,
this
is, I don't know what.
Now we're spending a lot of money.
You're spending money on it. But if you're deciding you're going to do a lot of these, they're relative. Now, you do need something on the other end that's going to be able to take HDMI into the computer.
Depending on your jurisdiction, this would be illegal.
It's illegal everywhere in the United States.
In the U.S. of A, and
I don't know where
Taylor could be in Pakistan.
If you're in Pakistan, you're probably okay.
It's probably legal. So I'm not going to make any judgments. In my opinion, if you have legally purchased content and you want to put it in a different format, that should be legal. As long as you're not burning a disc and selling it to your friends,
Right. You're
making a digital copy for yourself so it's more convenient. I see no ethical hazard.
I have no ethical problem with it.
And I don't think the copyright police are going to come pounding on your door.
Until you put it online.
Don't sell it.
Yeah.
Don't BitTorrent it. So there are ways to do this. This is very inexpensive.
Also, don't take the files across borders.
Yeah.
Keep them at home.
Yeah. So
if you're looking at just building a media server so that you can make all the stuff available and you don't have to think about all this stuff and you want to do it, that's fine.
Right.
The places you get stuck is you don't want to go into other countries and then back
again.
Don't do the wrong thing. All those things.
Yep. Do the right thing.
So,
you know,
if you're just
your stuff, you can move it around in your house.
It's all good.
The reason we have this, you may wonder why we have something labeled HDCP stripper. Well, a lot of times we want to display video from like a Mac onto the screen, right? And because of copy protection, it really hobbles our ability to do that
right. Because
not every part of the chain is HDCP compliant. So this thing. We just put this in between this and, say, our Blackmagic video converters and everything works.
We have issues where we have, let's say, a cable feed, and we want to put it into an SDI router and then have it appear on a screen
right. Somewhere
else,
right. And
we can't do that.
Not an illegal act in and of itself, although because of the DMCA, the Digital Millennium Copyright Act, it is illegal to circumvent copy protection, and that's effectively what this does. And the same thing, if you go out and buy software that does this, that converts iTunes. There's lots of software out there. And the reason it's expensive is basically they're taking a lot of chances. Even, you know, Slysoft, which is a company we love, I think they're out of Trinidad. I can't remember. They're somewhere in the Caribbean. The long arm of the U.S. copyright protection folks was able to reach out to them and put them out of business. They've resurfaced under a different name and different website. So you got to be careful about that kind of thing. I think for personal use of your own content that you purchased, no harm, no foul.
And again, we stay pretty careful with it from a professional perspective. But
you have to. You should.
You gotta.
We're not encouraging piracy by any means.
Right.
But that's where that's why what you want to do is difficult.
Right.
Copy protection.
Now, if you want to do just some conversion, one of the two things that we tend to use, cheap ways of doing.
Yeah. Once you've stripped the copy protection out.
Right. And you want to convert it to something, IFFmpeg.
Oh, FFmpeg. Yeah.
Handbrake
is a front end, I believe, to FFmpeg.
Mm-hmm.
So the real tool that's available on Linux, it's available on Windows, is FFmpeg. Handbrake gives you a nice GUI on top of that. They're both free and open source. Handbrake is from Handbrake, HANDBRAKE, like a handbrake in a car, .fr.
Right.
And that thing will do all sorts of great stuff. Well, I think we have some beer to drink. Maybe some bourbon, too.
I'm going for the bourbon myself.
Don't ever do
this
at home, okay? Young people watching, this was more for the science. This show should be banned. This show is full of things.
We gave our body
such terrible people we are, but we do thank you for joining us. It's so nice to see you.
It's a pleasure to be here.
It's perfect that you should be here for the last two screensavers in the Brick House studio. Have a gear. Just take it with you. It's we got two.
I'll put it in the back of my convertible.
What do you want to plug?
I never, you know me, I never really have anything.
He's at Pixel Corp, like, but like if you want to know what he's doing, they do all sorts of great workshops and things.
Yeah, we're going to be, you definitely want to follow me. We're going to bring the membership back. We kind of put it on ice, so that's getting closer to the surface.
Oh, that's nice.
So we'll start talking about it more in October, but I'm just giving you a warning that we've kind of restructured it and figured it out.
And follow him on Twitter. It's L-I-N-D-S-A-Y, Alex, L-I-N-D-S-A-Y. That way, when he does make an announcer,
and I often send hints out of where I am, cryptic photos and everything else, so you can try to do a kind of a where's
Oh, Alex. I like it. Your last tweet, which was like 10 days ago, you do the first seven jobs thing.
Yeah, I thought that was really fun.
That's fun, isn't it? Farm worker, gym manager, pizza delivery, shipping and receiving, metal fabricator, process server, radio DJ. It's great to see those lists because I think people, young people, realize, oh, you don't just launch into your career. You got to do a lot of stuff before you do your career.
Well, and one of the things I thought was really interesting is I didn't think about it until I saw someone else, you know, do it. And then when I wrote those out, I thought about all the things that I learned.
Right.
You know, right. As a farm worker.
You never
mostly
start
that I
off.
Don't want to do yeah, that don't, anymore.
That's the first thing you learn.
You learn the certain things, but there was, you know, pizza delivery especially. I did that for a week. Yeah. But
1 week?
Oh yeah, I actually did it for one day. I delivered pizza for a day, and then I was like, I am never doing this again. I didn't even get a check. I was like, I didn't even call back. I just disappeared. That was the only time I ever did that. It's good.
I worked at McDonald's, college library, college dining hall. I was a busboy at Denny's. I was a record clerk at Odyssey Records, and then I got my first job in radio. So that was job six.
See, my first job on radio was job seven.
Yeah. One ahead.
Yeah, exactly.
Hey, it was a lot of fun. I thank you for being here. Thanks to our live studio audience. You're here on an auspicious day, the last new screensavers in the Brick House. We will continue to do shows out of the studio here until Sunday. Our last show will be the radio show on August 21st. And then we're going to jump into the cable car. We got a cable car to the new studio. And we're going to bring a camera so you can watch live. And we'll go over to the new studio. And our first twit will be a week from tomorrow. Out of the new East Side studio. We're moving on up.
That's awesome.
To the East Side studio. If you want to watch the show, 3 p.m. Pacific, 6 p.m. Eastern time every Saturday, that's 2200 UTC. You can also watch the download on demand anytime you want. Audio and video at twit.tv/NSS. Be in the studio audience. Not next week. There's no studio audience. In 2 weeks, email tickets at twit.tv. It'd be fun to be here for the first show from the new studio. I think it'll be a lot of fun. And the fire marshal is going to be watching carefully. So we really want to pack that hall, pack that room as big as we can. So email tickets at twit.tv. Thank you, Alex Lindsay.
Thank you.
Thank you to our great team that puts this show together every week. You do a wonderful job, Tanya Hall, Jerry Wagley, Anthony Nielsen. And thanks to a special cameo appearance by Allyn Malventano. We'll see you on Twit tomorrow. I'm Leo Laporte. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time on the new Screensavers. Bye-bye.